Hello.
Good evening and welcome to the Ford Foundation. My name is Martina Bregu and I'm the Vice President for Democracy, Rights and Justice here at Ford. And it is my honor, pleasure and privilege to welcome you to the 8th annual Emilio Mignone Lecture on Transitional Justice, organized by the International Center for Transitional Justice, ICTJ, and the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice at New York University Law School. It is an honor to welcome you today because of the caliber of our main speaker, the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights, Zeid Raad al-Hussein, who you will hear more about in a few minutes. It is a pleasure because of the long-standing partnership between ICTJ and the Ford Foundation, a relationship that dates back to the very beginning of this organization whose work we have always admired in recent years under the remarkable leadership of David Tolbert. ICTJ and Ford have many things in common, and one of them is that we share the thoughtful and committed leadership of Kofi Appentank, who is the chairman of our respective boards. But introducing this event is a rare privilege because this lecture is named after one of my personal heroes, Emilio Mignone, one of the founding fathers of the human rights in my home country, Argentina. For those of you who don't know about Emilio, let me just say that his daughter was kidnapped and eventually disappeared by the military junta in Argentina in 1976. And this traumatic event transformed Emilio into a literally fearless advocate who began filing habeas corpus representing the relatives of the victims, and then move on to create the Center for Legal and Social Studies, CELS, one of the most well-known human rights organizations in Argentina and abroad. But on a more personal note, Emilio was my mentor. He took me under his wing when I was around 25 years old, and he taught me everything. I have many anecdotes about his mentoring, but let me share just one. During my first year as executive director of CELS, he used to call me every day at 6 a.m. in the morning to read me the newspapers. Who does that? You know, who calls his executive director at 6 a.m. in the morning every day? I have to say, not even Darren Walker. You know, I'm sorry, that's an internal joke, but I had to make it, okay. But you know, the key thing here is Emilio wanted me to be sure that I learned how to read the news between the lines. And also that I understood what did those stories mean for a human rights organization, because he was persuaded that only an informed and accurate understanding of our context would give us a strategic comparative advantage to do our work. When Emilio passed away, in one of the many obituaries that were written during those days, a good friend said that he was irreplaceable, and I'm afraid he was right, because of the unique way he combined an inexorable commitment to human rights values and principles with a healthy dose of pragmatism and sound political judgment. As we struggle to answer the question that is at the center of our conversation today, what hopes for the fight against impunity, there is no doubt that what we need are more visionaries like Emilio, who take on his legacy to defend human rights in the most challenging context, being truthful to those values, but at the same time able to effectively respond to the threats and constraints that we need to face. So I am really glad that we are here today to hear from one of them. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Meg Satterthwaite, and I'm one of the faculty directors of the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice. We're very pleased to co-host this event tonight, and I'd like to very much thank the Ford Foundation for hosting us. We are extremely pleased to partner in this lecture with the International Center for Transitional Justice and thrilled to host the High Commissioner and journalist Indira Lakshmanan tonight. I'd like to thank them both for taking the time out of their extremely challenging schedules. And it's really important that we ask the question, what hope for in the fight against impunity? As Martine already explained, this lecture series has a special legacy, if you will. And we've had this lecture series beginning in 2007, named after the Argentine lawyer and advocate Emilio Mignone. We honor him with a lecture series to keep alive his contributions to human rights and transitional justice. We honor him because he turned what could have been debilitating despair into action. Action not only on his daughter's behalf, but on behalf of all those who had been disappeared or tortured, and on behalf of all those families who were left behind. His was in many ways a quest for justice born of spoiled hope. By founding cells in Buenos Aires, Mignone embodied the spirit of speaking truth to power, fighting for human rights, and seeking what would later come to be known as transitional justice. Cells was central in the effort to systematically document, denounce, and legally challenge human rights abuses committed by the military during the dictatorship. Today, of course, Cells is one of the most important voices in Latin America in the fight for human rights and democracy. The work of Mignone and Cells has been influential across the world. This influence has been felt in the human rights world and, very crucially, in the development of the field of transitional justice. The work Cells undertook to document grave abuses during Argentina's most painful moments has been crucial in later attempts to bring to justice those who were responsible for those violations. The work of Emilio Mignone and Cells has been inspiring to the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice at NYU, which endeavors to use our position at a U.S. law school to advance scholarship and action in the name of truth and justice. We're honored to be led in this work by Professor Philip Alston, who himself has documented myriad cases of disappearance and killing during his time as Special Rapporteur on extrajudicial executions. And he now spends his time prodding governments and powerful international actors to protect the rights of those living the human rights violation of extreme poverty. The Center for Human Rights and Global Justice was thrilled when Professor Pablo de Grief joined us as director of our Transitional Justice Project. Professor de Grief's work as Special Rapporteur on the promotion of truth, justice, reparation, and guarantees of non-recurrence is blazing a pioneering path by focusing not only on the legal obligations of states, the rights of the victims, but also on the moral requirement of accountability. This work is especially important in this time and place. As we'll hear tonight, challenging impunity is one of the central preoccupations of leaders working to advance human rights in the world, whether far away or close to home. I would be remiss if I didn't mention, right here at home, our own work on behalf of clients who were themselves victims of the U.S. program of disappearance called Extraordinary Rendition. This work is important to remember tonight because tomorrow it will have been 1 year since the U.S. Senate released its report on the torture program. Despite that glimmer of hope represented by the release of that report, impunity continues. Beyond this, I'd like to say a few words about the purpose of this lecture, which is really the cornerstone of a collaboration with the International Center for Transitional Justice. The annual lecture is one attempt to break the logjam of impunity by fostering dialogue. Dialogue between academics and practitioners, between scholars and advocates, between actors in different fields and across professions. But more important than who is at the table is the goal of the dialogue, which is to foster a better understanding of the mechanisms that lead to human rights violations, foster impunity, and hamper the quest for accountability. Since its inception, the goal of this lecture has been to foster this kind of conversation and to think in innovative ways, ways that can move us toward more effective and meaningful action, even when hope appears to be gone. Previous speakers in the lecture series include Jose Zalaket, Louise Arbour, Aria Nair, Thomas Bergenthal, Hossam Bagat, and Richard Goldstone. The lecture is one of the central elements of our collaboration with the ICTJ. Under the direction of Pablo de Grief, our project on international transitional justice brings together teaching, research, conferences, and fieldwork. In addition to this program, we take on a thematic focus every 2 years, which I think is particularly relevant here at the Ford Foundation. What we're looking at right now is social and economic rights, the global economy, and inequality, with an emphasis on policy and economic justice. The aim of this multi-year program is to critically examine the role of human rights law in regulating the global economy and countering its tendency to exacerbate inequality. In closing, I'd like to just mention again, we're delighted to partner in this event, which speaks directly to one of the most crucial and intractable issues facing the world, that of impunity. I invite you not to sit back, but instead to join in. We all must be part of this important dialogue and insist on the quest for justice, even in the face of spoiled hope. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm David Tolbert. I'm the president of the International Center for Transitional Justice, and it's great to see all of you here tonight. And I'm very pleased that we're going to have a longtime friend of mine and a great friend of ICTJ, High Commissioner Zeid. He's a great champion for human rights, and looking very much forward to his conversation tonight. You know, everyone who is in charge of an event always likes to have a little bit of free publicity beforehand. And this afternoon, I came across UN Rights Chief Trump grossly irresponsible to propose Muslim ban. So I think we're off to a great start. both in substance, and this was on Reuters. So I think we'll be we've already gotten some attention. I want to thank Martin for that for his warm welcome to Ford and for saying a few words about Emilio Mignone, who was a real pioneer in the modern human rights movement and a leader in the field of transitional justice. And I want to thank our co-organizers, the Center for Human Rights and Global Justice at NYU Law School, and particularly Meg for her opening remarks. I do want to take just a second to recognize one special individual here, my predecessor at ICTJ, Juan Mendez, who is now the special rapporteur for the prevention of torture. Juan is around here somewhere, and it's always great to have Juan. Thanks for coming. Juan drove up from Washington and made it just in time, so thanks for being here, Juan. I think as we all look at the world today, we're all too aware that we're in an era of massive human rights abuses by a whole variety of actors, and with very limited accountability at best for those abuses. So given this troubling state of the world at present, this year's lecture on transitional justice really examines what I think is a fundamentally important question, the question of the international community's commitment to the fight against impunity. If we look back at the arc of transitional justice from its emergence really in the 1980s, the struggle against impunity has always been at the heart of the idea of transitional justice. If we look back in the early 80s, 1981, to the very important decisions, the very important set of recommendations coming out of the UN Human Rights Council, which called for truth and for justice, for accountability in the cases of enforced disappearances in Uruguay, which has also been followed by very important other precedents, and particularly in the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, followed by the wide use of truth commissions and international tribunals in the 80s and the 90s in places like South Africa, Guatemala, Bosnia and Herzegovina, to Tunisia today. We've seen efforts at ensuring the fight against impunity. Also, if we look more recently to the trial in Guatemala of Rios Montt and the efforts of civil society there and civil society groups in the DRC, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, to see justice in military courts for the epidemic of sexual violence in eastern Congo. So we also see many things that are troubling on the scene today. Whether it's in Syria and the Central African Republic and South Sudan and elsewhere, where impunity seems to reign. So it is this struggle, this fight against impunity, that really motivated ICTJ to open this global online debate. And it's not just the people in this room, as important as you are, but this is being watched by many, many people over the internet as well. So this question of the international community's struggle against impunity and at a crossroads, I think we have a tremendous speaker to address this. And I would note that ICTJ sponsored an online debate on this question: has the international community abandoned the fight against impunity, with High Commissioner Zeid and Michael Ignatieff, who's a well-known scholar. A very lively debate. I encourage you to go read it. You can decide who got the best of whom, but I'm with Zeid, of course. We had Fatou Bensouda, who is the ICC prosecutor. We had Betty Murungi, who is a very well-known activist coming out of Kenya and was a member of the Truth Commission there. We had R.A. Nair, who participated, and then a number of policymakers, activists, and victims representatives, scholars, and practitioners. So tonight is very much a continuation of that discussion, and which we find very critical at this particular moment. I have already mentioned places that, such as Syria, where there's ongoing conflict, where there seems to be very little will in terms of the fight against impunity. On the other hand, we're seeing important steps in Colombia, where we have a peace process that's moving forward with an important component of justice. So there's much to be discussed. I would note on another positive step, we have the European Union has recently adopted a policy on transitional justice, which declares the European Union's political will and financial commitment to supporting transitional processes across the world. And I would also note the African Union is currently considering a policy on transitional justice, which I think we should all watch with a great deal of interest. On the other hand, this contrasts with the lack of action, particularly by the Security Council, when we think of Syria and a variety of other countries, and particularly the stalemate between the permanent members of the Security Council. So this is why we're here tonight. I think we'll continue a very interesting and lively discussion, and I'm deeply pleased that with our participants. We have High Commissioner Zeid. I will introduce him. He assumes his functions as the High Commissioner in September 2014. I think a year goes very quickly, Zeid. He was appointed by the General Assembly, approved his appointment by the Secretary General. He had previously been Jordan's permanent representative to the United Nations in New York in two different terms, and also in Washington. And he is the former president of the Assembly's State Parties of the International Criminal Court. We have Indira Lakshmanan, who is, I am delighted to have as the interviewer. She'll be posing, no doubt, a few tough questions to Zeid, but he can take it, I can assure you. She's reported from over 80 countries in Asia, Latin America, Europe, and the Middle East. I think you are traveling more than I am, so I'm impressed with that resume. She's covered the State Department for Bloomberg News, and abroad as a foreign correspondent for the Boston Globe for over a decade. She's traveled regularly with the U.S. Secretary of State and interviewed Secretary of State Clinton some dozen times on Bloomberg TV. So I think we've got a great interviewer for a great interviewee. And so I'm going to step off the stage, and I'm going to turn the rest over to you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you all for coming tonight, and to everyone who is watching online live, you're very welcome as well. And I want to thank ICTJ for inviting me to facilitate this conversation. I have known the High Commissioner since he was ambassador in Washington. and have been following closely his work for the last year in this new position. And, you know, I was struck when I was listening to Meg talking about some of the past esteemed speakers you've had, including Jose Pepe Zalaquet, who, it takes me back to my first assignment as a journalist in Chile, covering the transition from Pinochet to democracy. And the whole reason I went there and became a journalist was my interest in transitional justice. So I'm really happy and excited to be part of this and to be able to sort of follow it from that to Bosnia to where we are today. So, of course, this is a lecture, High Commissioner, about, or a discussion, let's say, about the link between transitional justice and the struggle against impunity internationally. So I want to sort of start, we'll get to specific cases that are in the news today, but I want to start by sort of the broad brush picture. And one thing that strikes me as I look at the headlines is that there seems to be almost a growing rejection of international and supranational institutions seeking justice. So we have the African nations who have banded together against the ICC. We have Russia recently passing a law saying that any decisions of the European Court of Human Rights that are in conflict with its own constitution, it will not abide by. We have rising powers, be they democratic ones like India, Brazil, and South Africa, or authoritarian ones like Russia and China, less interested in supporting an international system of justice. So I want to ask you what you see as the future, given these conditions. In the next 10 years, what do you see as happening in international justice, and how much clout can these institutions still have?
Yeah, it's good to see you too. You know, Indira was part of this gaggle of very distinguished journalists in Washington who, in covering the State Department, they affectionately called themselves the Diplo Babes. And that's how we knew them. And they were formidable. So I, although I'm sitting back in my chair, I can assure you my thoughts are at the front. Well, let me start from at least the beginning for me. And the beginning was on the 17th of July, 1998, in the Red Room of the FAO headquarters in Rome, where we took this momentous decision to adopt the Rome Statute. And we were all delirious in believing that after a number of years, several years of negotiation, we had ourselves, the negotiators, the lawyers involved, we had changed the world. And of course, to our shock and horror, the world hadn't changed as fast as we had hoped it would. But you still feel that it will. And because there's so many students here, it reminds me of a time many years ago when I was just about to finish my doctoral thesis, and I was living with a friend who had already completed that doctoral thesis and was applying for postdoc fellowships. And we both thought ourselves to be super smart people. And certainly he thought he was smarter than I was, and I thought he was smarter than I was. And he sent out his applications to these various universities applying for postdoc fellowships. And to our joint shock and horror, the first thing that came back in the mail was an unopened envelope with his application and these sized 12 footprints all over the application. And we were completely stunned. I thought, if this man is smarter than I am, and I think I'm really smart, and they don't even open up his envelope to look at his application, you know, what hope do we have? And then, of course, things began to change. He began to receive acceptances and then interviews, and now he's a leading professor of history, and he's head of his department at his academic establishment. The point is that you sort of know it's going to work. You have confidence in the fact that you've done the right thing. We have a fine statute. We have a fine institution. It's not perfect, and we all know that. But it anchors a system that will still have its time in the sun. We know this. It's just a matter of having a few things work in your favor. And I have no doubt that had the South African authorities abided by the instruction of the Pretoria High Court to detain Omar Hassan al-Bashir when he was in Johannesburg for the AU summit, we could well be living in a changed world where the repercussions would have been felt in Burundi, it would have been felt in Syria and in Iraq, in many, many places. And we're not that far away from achieving a result. And we know that the torque is there. In the case of Yemen, for instance, we issued a report in July and we called for an international investigation to look into the enormous casualties caused by the coalition bombing. The Yemeni authorities then counter-proposed the setting up of a domestic investigation, which we received warmly. We thought these are not mutually exclusive and let's give them the opportunity to do this. In the Human Rights Council, a negotiation began on a draft. And what was really extremely interesting was the amount of pressure leveraged on the negotiators to give Yemen a chance to proceed with a domestic investigation was testimony to the power of what it is that we're all trying to do, what David's trying to do, what all of us are trying to do, and that is to open a door to a different sort of future, where 200,000 years of human and unreserved, excess in terms of violence is finally brought under some control. Under, as our good friend Ben Ferenc said, under the mantle of international criminal law that is binding. So I'm not pessimistic, I'm optimistic. You can feel disheartened, but I think we can make this work, and it's just a matter of being patient. Eventually, pieces will fall into place.
Well, I'm interested throughout our discussion in hearing more about your views on international justice institutions in general, but since you bring up the ICC, and of course you were in fact the president of the State Assembly for the ICC, let's drill down on that a little bit. You in the ICTJ debate, you called the ICC the distillation of humanity's common thirst for justice, and you said it testified to the joint commission of the member states to deliver it. But at the last meeting of the state parties to the Rome Statute, we saw a lot of turmoil, and we saw this African community mutiny led by South Africa alleging anti-African bias, some of them even calling for the withdrawal from the ICC. So is there any credence to the allegations they make that the ICC is a tool in the hands of big powers?
No. And the turmoil was caused by the fact that I wasn't there. I mean, this was the, Well, we had a similar experience a few years ago when the president of Kenya was very close to having to present himself before a hearing at The Hague. On his behalf, six ministers from African countries came to the UN Security Council and lobbied to have a resolution adopted under Article 16 of the Rome Statute to have the jurisdiction of the court sort of suspended, if you will. And this was firmly rejected by members of the Security Council. There was no appetite for it. So then they proceeded to The Hague for an Assembly of States party. We had a session ongoing. And they came and they were in no mood for pussyfooting around this issue. And they one of the proposals was to have a redrafting of Article 27, the irrelevance of official capacity article. And of course, I think everyone, and there are many here in this audience who were there, And at the time, but we were expecting a colossal clash between the members of the African Union, who were very, very emotional about this, and then the rest of the membership of the ICC that was absolutely not going to move in that direction. So I was asked to chair a panel that included a number of very fine and distinguished colleagues to discuss the merits of what it is that the African nations were proposing and to have a controlled discussion. And so the normal procedure is that you give the floor to the state's parties and then you have the observers speak. And right at the end of the discussion, probably way into the evening, you ask the NGOs to speak. So I immediately declared that we were going to follow the 10-5-3 rule, and I gaveled, and we proceeded on that basis. And I invented the 10-5-3 rule right at the right there and then, made it seem that it was something well established in practice. And the idea was you have 10 states parties speak, and then you quickly move to the observers, and then you have the NGOs speak. And what we were treated to was a magnificent discussion between the African NGOs who spoke and the African delegations. In fact, I think for most of us, we just sat there mesmerized. And it was very dignified, it was very direct, it was learned. And at one stage, someone said, you know, why are we doing it here in The Hague in front of everyone? We should be doing it at home. We should be doing it at home. And so I thought at that stage we had averted the worst of it. There were then some amendments discussed and some accepted and a couple of new regulations. But basically we thought we had averted it. In the case of the vice president of Kenya, of course, it all came back and there were other articles that were being looked at. But I suppose if we're philosophical about it, as we transition from a political world where expediency reigns to a world where principle begins to really take root, and that there is no getting away from the fact that the law is well rooted in human experience to the extent that there is almost no new human experience. Everything we've experienced or experienced now is a permutation of previous experiences that the law captures by and large. Now, I have to be careful here. Of course, I'm very well aware that with the advance of technology, we have to, you know, of course, expand the envelope when it comes to things hitherto unexpected or not anticipated. But by and large, the major components, when you look at international criminal law, and the four core crimes, I mean, we are sort of fairly comfortable in that area. I believe we will get through this. The challenges are there, certainly, but we will get through these convulsions and this turbulence because, quite simply, there is no alternative. You know, no detractor has come forward with a better solution as to how we deal with this. No one is saying we go back to a situation where amnesties reign and impunity is there, and it doesn't matter that this neighbor killed and or raped and killed this neighbor's daughter. We can all get along and forget, and the past is the past, and so forth. We're well beyond that. It's just working our way through this transitional phase and getting to the other end, and we will do so. I'm fairly confident about that.
All right. Well, one of the sort of landscapes where there are horrific human rights violations going on right now, we all know, is Syria. And you have spoken about this in your opening statement at the 30th session of the Human Rights Council. You referred to the horrible human rights violations and to the international community's failure to act. And you said that unless everyone changes dramatically how we think and behave as international actors, all of us in the human rights community will be inconsequential in the face of such mounting violations. But at the same time, in ICTJ's online debate, you said that the international community's commitment to fight against impunity still is there. So what is it?
Yeah,
when it comes to Syria?
It's very good. I mean, there is a sense of, ay, 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 ay. Oh, gosh, at the end of the day. Oh, look. No, it's very, It's very, I mean, you remind me of an interview I had with the BBC, the Arabic service, where the lady was very punchy. And she said to me, "Hi, Commissioner, how bad are things?" And I said, "Things are very bad." She said, "Really bad?" I said, "Well, no, there's certain things that are also quite good." She said, "Well, is it good or is it bad?"
Half empty or half full.
No, I mean, look, there is no doubting that at times you just feel unequal to the challenge presented before you.
And the challenge of Syria is huge between Assad and ISIS.
Globally, it's massive. I mean, you know, we like to think that there are special conflicts. I mean, special in the sense that the crimes are so extreme that there is no parallel. But I believe Tom Bergenthal was right when he spoke to an audience once, and I was listening to him, and he said, really, in all of these conflicts, you go to the extreme, and they're all pretty bad, and they're all the same. The extreme is the worst you can possibly contemplate, and it happens. And I think that's the case. I think what happens is that your reason tells you we just have to keep burrowing away. We will get there. We will get to where it is that we want to get. But there is no doubt that at times the sense of personal insufficiency, self-insufficiency, it makes its mark, because you can't deliver what the victims want you to deliver immediately. And when you sit with communities of victims, victims of torture, Juan has experienced this time and again, or Pablo, you know, they look at you for delivery. And certainly your words can have a calming effect on them. But you feel, I cannot bring back the lives they once had. I cannot bring back the missing relatives that were part of their family. And so who am I kidding, you know, talking about justice or making speeches or giving television interviews? I mean, you know, it's so unequal to the colossal challenge that we face. So you go through that, because we're only human and we're not robotic to just be parroting the same line. And at times you're going to feel disheartened. There was one interview where I almost sort of came apart in the interview, because I very much felt that what I was doing was almost akin to fraud. You know, who was I kidding? Who was I kidding? This is so short of where we need to be as an international community in terms of how we save future generations from this appalling violence that we see. So you feel that, yes. I don't think it's contradictory. It's just human emotion. So I'm trying to get myself out of your...
Well, I'm going to press you on it a little bit. Let's flash forward to a much hoped for, hopefully not too distant future, in which the Syrian conflict is over. If and when that happens, yes, you can't bring back the lives of the victims, but potentially the international community could bring accountability for the perpetrators.
Yeah.
So how do you envision anyone from Bashar al-Assad and his regime to the ISIS leadership and the actors who've carried out these atrocities on both sides being held accountable? Do you see it through the ICC? Do you see it through international tribunals or something that would take place in Syria? What's your vision?
Yeah, it could be. I mean, it's difficult to predict at this stage. We're seeing the very earliest stages now of a peace process coming together. The lines are faint, but there are certainly lines of convergence in the positions of the main protagonists in this, outside of Syria, the regional and international sort of protagonists involved. And certainly, so we can allow ourselves to think that at some stage the fighting will cease, and then we can make an assessment. The danger is, of course, that there is going to be a front opened up against so-called ISIS. If driven out of Syria, where do they all end up? You will end up having a disbursement to many different countries. Many of the governments know this, and so there are sort of other issues that will follow. But in the context of Syria, you hope that whatever transitional arrangement then ensues, that it leads to a thirst for accountability, for a sense that that there needs to be a reckoning. I think the idea that you can just bury it and put it behind you just simply won't wash. We see this in other contexts, and I think the work that Pablo has done in many of the post-conflict situations is invaluable, that you cannot run away from your past. Memory is a very mysterious sort of part of our lives. So 70 years can pass between the sexual violence that a so-called comfort woman experienced during World War II. And yet when you sit with this this lady who's gone through this, you know that with a few words and a few seconds, you can make that lady weep. 70 years for that, the victim of torture, the victim of sexual violence, the victim of horror, is meaningless. Time collapses in on itself so quickly that it would seem like it happened a few seconds ago. The notion that somehow you can bury all of this under layers of generations that will forget, I think has been so disproven, because it can be dug up by those who don't care about history. I mean, just look at all the racists and bigots, the political leaders in so many parts of Europe who are willing to deny history, almost believe it never existed, because they're repeating and doing very much what their forebears did almost 100 years ago. They don't want to accept that there is a parallel, that they're sort of stoking the very same fears, the very same incendiary that existed only a couple of generations ago, or three generations ago. And so that surely is evidence of the fact we cannot repeat this, and we need to plunge much deeper into what it is that caused these conflicts, why they exist, how we drag the truth out that is unassailable, and on the basis of truth build narratives that bind people together in a permanent peace. And that is why this is so important. It's not just the plaything of lawyers with spare time on their hands. No, it's so serious, and the sooner the political world understands this, it's not an adjunct, it's not an auxiliary afterthought. It is the key issue that has to be sorted out when a peace agreement is struck.
So the atrocities that are happening today in Syria cannot be swept under the rug,
not only because
of the victims and the survivors of victims, but also for the sake of history and the rest of us in the world, and sending a message that impunity will not be accepted. So then my question is, how do you see this playing out? Would it be something that would happen in a UN setting, in an ICC setting? Would the United States, or should the United States, try to set up a tribunals? How do you see justice being served? What's realistic?
You reach now, and this is going to be, I'm going to open up the door to many questions here. I mean, if you had a case where you have transitional authorities that say, you know, we want to accede to the Rome Statute, and we want to file a 12-3 application, so basically we can go back and mark a point in time when the jurisdiction of the court will enter into force. Then that certainly is a possibility. I mean, that is a possibility. There is the situation of the Golan Heights and Israel's occupation. And you cannot separate, I think, in terms of territorial jurisdiction, the issues. And so it would be difficult maybe for the U.S. to go along with that, almost impossible. And so other formulations would probably have to be looked at. But we would encourage them to move in this direction, as we've encouraged the Iraqis to accede to the Rome Statute. They sort of move in fits and starts. At some stages, we feel that they're really going to push this forward, and then they pull back. Partly because, of course, everyone knows that in a conflict, It's not just one side that will be accused of having committed these offenses, but accusations are likely to be spread rather broadly, and so fear of potential investigation and prosecution will ensue. I mean, but on the other hand, it gives the country a chance to really build up its own judiciary, to establish its own capabilities in terms of addressing these issues. And you know, eventually one has to accept that unless you have a functioning judiciary, and judiciary that's independent, of course, can you be called a state? You might be an entity with political activity and trade taking place daily, but I think it's very clear that if you're going to have institutions functioning, they need to be anchored to a judicial system in place that works and is free.
All right.
Or independent.
I want to briefly address the backdrop to the Syrian crisis, which is, of course, the so-called Arab Spring, where, with the exception of Tunisia, essentially that spring has turned to a winter. And you see authoritarian regimes across the region, Egypt, massive abuses in Yemen and Libya. In your view, what went wrong with the Arab Spring, particularly with respect to human rights? And do you see a role for your office and for organizations like ICTJ for the future?
Yeah, I think what was clear to me, at least, is that there was no authentic Arab liberal philosophy in place to anchor or give a sort of expression to the sentiments of all the young people who wanted and sought a democratic, pluralistic existence. And there are some colleagues here from the region who I think hopefully will support me in this, in the sense that if you invoked the liberal philosophies of Western thinkers, immediately in the Arab world, you would be accused that these are, you would say, I suppose, sort of imported thoughts, afkar mustawrada, these are not authentically from the region. And with the demise of the Ba'ath Party and Arab socialism more broadly, and the weakness of the sort of the communist movement, there was no alternative to the default position of Islam, but more particularly of the ideologies to the extreme. And so there was no counterbalance. And if you look at the 1848 revolutions in Europe, it was accompanied by an emergence of a European liberal political philosophy or philosophies that were not in existence in the Arab world in 2011. And so the default was, it was simply not enough to have people in the street. It needed a broader elaboration, and then upon which you could build political platforms that seemed to be authentically from the region and not imports. And I think that was principally what accounted for the fact that it didn't work.
Do you see a role for the UN, for your office, or for NGOs in promoting concepts of human rights in the Arab world now that the sort of Arab Spring has dissipated?
I sometimes, when you talk to me like this, I think I have so much to do.
Sorry. Don't rush back to your office yet.
I mean, how much can an office take? I want to go home.
No, you want to go back to the office.
No, I
do
of
good
course,
work.
I mean, of course, you know, of course, we need to make it more broadly known. I mean, part of the problem we have, and I hope some of the colleagues here who are very much part of the human rights ecosystem family will help me with this. I mean, part of the problem we have is that our work is still too much the work of experts, in the sense that all of those who come to the Human Rights Council sessions tend to be human rights activists and experts. Those who interact with us are experts within governments and our national human rights institutions, ombudspersons. I think one of the, of course, crucial missing parts of this is the outreach to the public more generally, and to explain what human rights are without sounding overly technical, without sounding overly cumbersome. When I had my first press conference, and I had to prepare an opening statement, and my office gave me a statement. I wish I kept it, because I would love to have read to you the first two or three paragraphs. And I said to them, I can't possibly read this. I can read this to delegates who are well used to the soporific reading of a text, but we need metaphors, we need parallels. We need to break this down into verse that is understandable to everybody. And for example, I was much impressed by an intervention made by the human rights representative of the European Union, Stavros Lambrinidis, when he was trying to explain what universality meant. And because, of course, as many of you know, universality has been challenged by many countries, cultures, traditions, with the sort of cultural relativist argument that the universal agenda is essentially an agenda of the West. It was a sort of creation of Eleanor Roosevelt and her group in the drafting committee of the Universal Declaration. It had a very limited bind from the rest of the world, and now the rest of the world has signed on, but is not accepting of the fact that this agenda is their agenda. And so Lambrinidis said, and if I can, since he might be watching this, I have to get this right. He said something to the effect that when you look at victims, the victim of, let's say, spousal abuse, of abuse, let's say sexual abuse, whether that victim is in Stockholm, in Amman, in Rio de Janeiro, or Jakarta, that victim knows that they've been abused. On the other hand, the government, and I don't mean those four governments, but the government that tries to protect the perpetrator, the husband, the partner, the brother, the father, whoever has done this abuse, will claim that special circumstances apply, that there is a tradition, that there is a culture. You never really hear it from the victim themselves. They understand that they're victims. And this is perhaps the clearest argument for the universal application and necessity of applying universal values. The architects of the Universal Declaration were not some, you know, crazy people. They had just lived through World War. They understood after two World Wars, within one lifetime, it could not be the same again. You know, and it still amazes me, it frightens me, I think all of you will agree, that if we tried to draft the exact terms of the Universal Declaration today, we couldn't do it. I mean, that's obvious. But isn't that a very sad sign of where we are, at least where the broad approach to human rights are concerned, and so leaving aside the accountability and the impunity arguments that we made earlier, that there is pushback? Certainly there is. Certainly there is. And I've said on more than one occasion that if I were to list all the countries where we see civil society collapsing under the weight of pressures from governments and extremist movements, where the space for dissent is being crushed, I couldn't name all the countries for fear of alarming the world that only a minority don't experience that. So, you know, there is pushback, yes. That we have to keep fighting? Certainly we must. That we will eventually get there? I'm sure we will. But it won't come easily, and it needs the buy-in of many, many people.
Well, you say that the language of human rights and fighting against impunity needs to be understandable to the general public, not just to experts. But I think that one thing the general public can understand is atrocities. When they read about it and hear about it, and of course experience it, they know what it is. So there are places in this world, not just Syria, but unfortunately others like South Sudan, Central African Republic, Burundi, where atrocities are happening right now as we speak on a large scale. And I'm wondering, in Burundi in particular, people are talking about another explosion of violence possibly being on the brink of a Rwanda-type genocide. So what is the international community doing to prevent this? Because really, you don't need transitional justice if you have prevention of impunity and the prevention of such violence and prevention of impunity in the first place.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I'm going to hire you after this event to help me make this case. I mean, obviously, you know, the UN humanitarian appeal just made of $20 billion, we would make the argument, of course, and we would fully support the call for our humanitarian partners, but we would make the argument that a little more invested in human rights protections and the human rights mechanisms and the follow-up to the Universal Periodic Review and supporting special procedures of the Human Rights Council in supporting the work of the treaty bodies would also be a very good antidote. And the budget that we have, as all of you know, is 3% of the UN budget, and we are one of the three pillars of the UN. And so it's farcical to suggest that this is enough, or even remotely enough. And last year I said, and I keep saying this, so I think I'll have a reaction. But the budget of my office is 1/10 of what the Swiss spend on chocolate every year. And that's, so when you add in all the foreigners who live in Switzerland, like myself, who love Swiss chocolate, I mean, it's not reasonable. The capital markets in the world today are valued at $136 trillion. When you sit with investment bankers and the heads of hedge funds, there's so much liquidity. I mean, they don't know what to do with it. And on the other side of the equation, we're struggling with just a few monies. I mean, we can't even get $100 billion to invest in the SDGs, which is a drop in the bucket when compared to the capital markets. So you have all this money. What are they going to do with it if the world collapses in on itself? It's sort of ridiculous. Yeah. And how can it be so obscenely lopsided? And so we need to think very differently if somehow we're going to hand over to the unfortunate generation of students who are sitting here wondering what's coming their way, a sort of world that it somehow has a chance of succeeding. And unless we do this, I think we are in peril. So I am optimistic, so long as we keep fighting and don't take anything for granted. But the pressures are certainly there.
I want to get to some of the
questions.
And I
didn't answer your Burundi question, nor the Syria question.
I noticed, but yeah. I need to get to some of the Twitter questions and Facebook questions that we've been collecting all day. But first, sitting here in New York, just blocks from the United Nations, I would be really remiss if I didn't ask you about the United States. We are 1 year since the Senate torture report came out just last week. Human Rights Watch released its own report demanding that there should be prosecution of Americans at the CIA and in the White House who were involved, who knew about this. So I want to ask you, can we talk about a U.S. commitment to fight against impunity if there has been no justice in those cases? And what's the role for your office, located here in New York, but of course the United Nations, where a powerful state claims a leadership role on the issue of human rights and justice, but fails to address fundamental violations, apparently, that its own president has said, we tortured some folks.
Yeah, you knew that I have a meeting with Samantha Power tomorrow morning.
Press her on this. She's written about it, she knows all about it.
So I can assume that the meeting will be canceled now. No, look, the Convention Against Torture, as all of you know, we need Juan to talk about this. I mean, it's very clear that the two sort of central components of the convention is that there are no exceptions. Torture in Article 2 is clearly defined, and there are no exceptional circumstances that can justify its use. And the second is that all must be held accountable. And we said this when the Feinstein report was issued, we still maintain it. And there is no latitude here, no wriggle room here. You can't debate it and argue around it. And, you know, and it's for very good reason. You know, there are no exceptional circumstances that merit it. You know, we've been through this time and again, generations after generations. And again, the law is the distillation of human experience and wisdom. So let's stick with it. You know, but to rationalize that I need to do this because of exceptional circumstances, new threats, I mean, it's all baloney, to use the American expression. So, there has to be accountability, I think, on this score.
So you'll be pressuring Ambassador Power for this, or pressing?
I think now that you've raised it in public in this intimate setting, I will have to, yes.
All right, good. All right, I want to raise this question, which came to us over the internet from International Coalition for the Responsibility to Protect. And they want to know, to what extent are there lessons learned from the transitional justice process in Bosnia and the Western Balkans that can be applied to the Syrian regime if it's ever brought in front of an international tribunal? It's a variation on the question I asked you earlier. But specifically, they want to know also about the initiative to prosecute ISIS foreign fighters from countries like the UK and the Netherlands under the personal jurisdiction procedure of the ICC for their part in the alleged genocide of the Yazidi population, among other war crimes. Is that realistic? Can that happen?
Yeah, it can happen, certainly. I mean, they could be prosecuted in their own countries, but that can certainly happen, assuming that they have extraterritorial jurisdiction. But that also sort of applies in the sense that I think it's Article 12 of the Rome Statute will cover it. But the first question, I'm not sure I understand the substance of it. I assume that, you know, could it be the case that you set up an ad hoc tribunal to cover Syria? And certainly that could be, although the appetite for it is not there. And since I have the mic, I'll go back to Burundi.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Burundi is, of course, very worrisome. And everyone who has been there recently, who has followed it, is very well aware of why we are all worried about the country. The political infighting can well spill into an ethnic dimension, which everyone is very worried about. The Burundian authorities have argued and claimed that the international reaction is an exaggeration. There is no fear of it becoming ethnically based. However, our position is that there are too many signs that suggest that this may well happen unless we stem the bloodshed that's still continuing, and the patterns of killings that is beginning to change from a certain category of targets into other victims. And so we are watching this very carefully, and I think the Security Council is very well aware of the dangers. I have to say, I mean, when I briefed the Council together with two other colleagues 3 weeks ago, I think it was, for the first time, at least for me, I saw some real emotion and passion about this. So we were so conscious of what happened 20 years ago, and that it wasn't just a normal set of interventions and deliveries, but highly passionate pleas made on behalf of the UN. And I think it helped the Security Council come draw into one position as opposed to a rather fragmented position which it had prior to that. So it is dangerous, and we are watching it.
We have a question all the way from Algeria on Facebook from Tofik Mato. So maybe you can give a short answer to this. Tofik is saying, in many cases, governments enact laws that justify serious human rights violations by senior civilian and military officials. How do we hold these people accountable because of the legal protection they enjoy in their home countries? And to what extent can transitional justice play an active role in
refuting this.
I think it was Sir Thomas More who spoke about the about tyranny being enforced by the law. And the other, I was writing a speech the other day, and I reminded myself of Cicero's famous saying that in war, the laws fall silent, and we have too many declared wars, so to speak, a war on terrorism, a war on extremism, whatever it may be, and so it seems to give certain actors in government the belief that the law can fall silent. I think we have to be very vigilant. We need to, you know, look at all these countries. And we do this in our office. It's an exhausting experience because you try and run through as many countries as you can, and you look at their human rights condition, what we understand about it, and where it's going. And then we write letters, communications, and there are communications from the special rapporteurs, from the treaty bodies themselves, in respect of these sorts of developments. And occasionally we go public, of course, if we feel that the pressure is merited and we need to do it. And we do it. And sometimes you're surprised. I mean, in one case, a foreign minister said to me, as we were discussing an issue, and she said to me, High Commissioner, please don't go public on us. And I thought, what a silly thing to say. She's just told me exactly what it is I have to do. And it's exactly what I have to do. And I've said this before publicly. And again, we know that we are a small office, but we know that we can exert pressure. And I have to say also that the help of the international media is prime here, because if the international media is on the side of the human rights agenda, on the side of those who speak for human rights, and I'm sure many of you will agree, it becomes an unequal fight for a government that's trying to argue in the opposite direction. And so we have means available, and together with our natural partners, NGOs in countries and national human rights institutions, we can forge alliances and raise these sorts of issues that you've mentioned, or that the colleague has mentioned.
As a former Latin America correspondent, I have to ask you about truth commissions, which are a personal interest, and I think for many people in this room. After Morocco and Sierra Leone, several of the truth commissions, such as Liberia, Ivory Coast, Kenya, have faltered. They've had serious difficulties. Do you see the model of the truth commission in crisis, and if so, why?
Oh, goodness. I mean, you're asking me a really difficult question because I have my personal belief and I have the office's position. And they're not the same.
Oh, then it's much more interesting, the answer.
So the office's position is that we do believe in truth commissions, that they fulfill a very vital function. And we support them, and we have technical expertise that can be supportive of this. And I see, of course, members of my staff here listening very carefully, wondering what am I going to say next. But my own belief is that it worries me that, and when I looked at many of the trials at the close of the Second World War, conducted by the Allies after Nuremberg, after the 12 subsequent trials, it was amazing to see how in the thousands of people convicted and the many hundreds then sentenced to death, when there was no appeal, how little contrition there was. No one, faced with the enormity of the evidence placed before them, said, on the steps of the gallows, what we did was wrong, what I did was really wrong. They had so thoroughly rationalized to themselves that what they did was right, that notwithstanding what evidence was placed before them, they weren't going to buy it. And so in me it creates a doubt about, you know, what exactly are you offering? Because when you look at those who claimed contrition, and in the case of the Auschwitz commandant, Rudolf Hoss, I mean, he wrote about it, but as Primo Levi said, it was never believable that this mass killer, you know, would tell the truth. He was telling a story to protect his family, but he didn't believe it. None of the survivors felt that he believed it. And so if you offer, if there is a quid pro quo, people will say all sorts of things. If you say to a person, tell the truth and you won't be prosecuted, they'll tell the truth. But it's whether they tell the truth with sincerity, with contrition, where they recognize the enormity of their wrongdoings. And the simple fact of the matter is that there are too few cases in the record which demonstrate that this is the rule rather than the exception. So I'm a bit of a skeptic when it comes to this. If you offer something, you will get something. But if you don't offer something, then, you know, and the case I think that most brings this out is the case, and I've discussed this with both with both David and our colleagues here, with Pablo, I discussed it with you, is the case of Franz Stangl. And if you read Gita Sereny's book, Into the Darkness, about her interviewing of Stangl, and he was the second commandant of Treblinka. And at the end of the fourth interview, she brought him to within a hair breadth of a full recognition of the enormity of what he had done. But it was an enormous exercise, and the way she managed to get him to that point is with very long pauses. She didn't interrupt, she just let him speak, and then for a pause would last half an hour, and she got him so close for him to say, yes, I committed, you know, an enormous, you know, enormous mass murder, 700,000 people at a minimum. So there's something we still don't understand fully about this that I think we do need to explore. I think it's not as easy as just saying, you know, people will tell the truth. People don't tell the truth simply because they don't know what the truth is when they've rationalized these barbaric deeds to themselves. And they sort of have managed to deflect it off themselves. And that explains how you get these most amazing things, you know, that Rudolf Voss would go to various crematoria in Birkenau and then in the evening go and lie on the floor and play games with his children. And so cleanly disassociate one from the other. The mental partitioning of these issues is just phenomenal. So on a personal level, I'm not so sure about them. But as a High Commissioner for Human Rights, I'm fully behind them.
And you have some, I could listen to you talk about this forever, and you have some terrific advice for interviewers, which is pause and let people fill the empty silence, because they will. And now I'm going to turn to this room full of experts and people so knowledgeable in this to fill the silence and ask their own questions. And this man's hand shot up first, so please. Maybe you could just, when the mic comes to you, yeah, that's a great idea. We'll take questions in threes. Just quickly identify who you are, make your questions succinct rather than a speech, and we'll take it in a group of three.
Good. I'm Jamie Metzl. I'm on the board of ICTJ. Thank you very much for your extremely thoughtful comments. I'm a great lover of human rights and also a great lover of chocolate, and so I hope we can have both in great abundance. But as you know, the issue of human rights in North Korea is coming back to the Security Council next week. This week. It's such a monumental issue. I think everybody knows all of the terrible things that are going on every day in North Korea. And everybody knows that there's one country on the Security Council that is keeping the North Korean regime alive and protecting it in the United Nations and elsewhere. What can your office do to encourage that Security Council permanent member to budge a little bit on North Korea?
And we'll say it out loud, China. All right, so that's one. Do we have another? Right back here, this person here.
I can wait, yeah. Yes, my name is Sri Jayanta. I'm not a human rights expert. My field is engineering. I'm here to raise the question on Sri Lanka.
Mm-hmm. Good.
The commissioner's office came up with a fantastic report in September where you are referring to the internal legal system in Sri Lanka is not adequate to address the atrocities that happened. Mm-hmm. Yet the resolutions have been somewhat shielding the Sri Lankan government at this point. So my question to you is that from the impunity standpoint, do you believe that the Sri Lankan government is being held responsible for the massacre of something of the order of 70,000 civilians, or you think it's going in the right direction?
Okay, and a third question. We have this lady right here, the blonde lady in the center.
Thank you. My name is Christina Cerna. I'm retired after more than three decades with the Inter-American Human Rights System. My question is, what are the new focuses that you would like to give to your office? And specifically, I'm wondering if you have any anticipation of the creation of a UN Human Rights Court. The UN Human Rights Treaty bodies have, in a way, been left in the dust compared to the European, Inter-American, and African human rights systems because they have courts that can issue legally binding judgments and order reparations. And do you see, say, for example, in the next 10 years, the creation of a UN Human Rights Court?
Okay. So I thank all three of you because you've asked three questions that were on my list that I hadn't gotten to. So we have first North Korea, and I just want to mention here that the UN had a commission of inquiry on North Korea that came up with a devastating report in February of last year, which I'm sure you remember, calling for the prosecution of senior leaders in the state security apparatus for crimes against humanity. But the UN did not go forward with any kind of prosecution, and China has protected North Korea from pursuing those prosecutions themselves. So let's start with that one.
Okay, so three questions. Don't know, yes, and yes.
Tick.
No, with China, I haven't had that discussion with them on the DPRK. I'm hoping to go to the DPRK in the early part of the year, and I will hopefully have discussions with the Chinese authorities about the DPRK in the ensuing period. On Sri Lanka, mm-hmm. I have to say, for me, Sri Lanka is a country that I think completely absorbs you. And I think everyone agrees, and Pablo is nodding. It's a fascinating country. It's a country with enormous potential. It's a country that we feel needs to not just, it's not just a matter of changing a few things and holding people accountable. Certainly that must happen, certainly. But it's a country that very much has to change almost its DNA, its culture of doing things, to realize what it needs to realize, and that is a future free of violence, where every individual is dignified by the state, and where every individual will feel that their rights are being respected. We feel we are on the right track, but it requires constant working, and certain things can happen quicker, absolutely the case. Other things have to happen slower. It's a matter of finding the right balance between all of it. But in our minds, you are absolutely right, sir, that we believe the, as currently configured, the domestic mechanism, or let's say a domestic mechanism without the significant integration of international participation, is not something that we believe will work. There are various permutations in terms of what it is that we're looking at and suggesting, and they are also looking at various permutations. And so I'm hopeful that Sri Lanka is on the right path, and I hope to also be visiting Sri Lanka soon. And so I'm optimistic about Sri Lanka. On the UN Human Rights Court, it could well be the case. I know there have been previous discussions about this in the past. I'm not up to date on why they founded and didn't materialize into a discussion, at least on the possibility of setting it up, a serious discussion. Perhaps the gentleman here can help me. I'm looking for anyone to help. No one's giving me the look like they know.
Volunteers.
I'm not getting any volunteers from an. So I will get back to you.
David, do we have time for another trio of questions? Okay, so one more round. There is a gentleman right back there who was patiently waiting before.
Thank you for giving me the floor. My name is Mohammed Ibrahim. I'm an Islamic law expert with the United Nations Department of Peacekeeping Operation.
The United Nations?
DPKO.
Okay.
Department of Peacekeeping Operations.
Former judge.
Yes. Okay. More into the microphone.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay.
Actually, I think I have to take the position of your officer regarding the right to know the truth. I think it's one of the principles in Sharia that all victims have to know why this happened. And the principle in Sharia saying that the newly born baby that was killed, one day she will come and ask why this happened to her. So I think it's a core value in Sharia that people would know why this happened to them. So I think I'm taking the position of your office here. My question regarding another alternative for Syria accountability, and matter of fact, it's the Middle East accountability. The League of Arab States established already the Arab Court of Justice, which is supposed to be seated in Bahrain. Do you think that this modality would be an alternative for accountability, not only in Syria, but in Iraq, Palestine, Egypt, Somalia, Libya? So I think the region have some gap in the middle here, and I think a court in the region might fill this gap, like the African, the Inter-Americans, and the European one. What do you think about that? Thank
okay.
you.
Okay. Second question. There's a hand that shot up right there. Yes, you.
Hi, my name is Kara Blackmore from the London School of Economics. You spoke about the need for metaphors, and we know that arts and culture becomes a very useful metaphor for understanding human rights and justice issues. So my question is, how do we become legitimate translators within your respective fields?
Sorry, could you repeat? Because I didn't hear you at the beginning.
How do we arts and culture practitioners become legitimate translators for the metaphors of human rights and justice that you talk about?
Oh, gosh, good question.
Okay.
And good question.
Do we have a third person? So everyone is pointing this way over here. Okay. Yes.
Joanna Meyer, African Views NGO. I'm wondering if there's an alliance of truth commissions and if there's knowledge management outside of the ICC or so that the as different countries are working on their own post-conflict situations, if they can partner with other countries that have had, quote unquote, more successful truth commissions. Thank you.
Right, so the first one was about the Arab Court of Justice and if that could be the place to take Syrian atrocities or Iraqi or other violations.
Yeah, okay, I'm a very big fan and admirer of Muhammad, so I don't like to disagree with him. On the Sharia, of course, I'm not going to dispute what you're saying, Muhammad. You're absolutely right. I think the point is, the truth as it emerges is in a set of facts that this conduct happened, these basic facts happened. Or is it a case that in the telling of the truth by the perpetrator, you want to see sort of contrition? You want to see, if someone does you a basic injustice on a daily basis, you would like to hear, I'm sorry. My wife likes to hear it from me, even if I haven't done anything wrong. But fact, in actual fact, I developed a means by which it was a very cunning device. I would wake up in the morning, and as soon as she woke up, I'd say, you know, my darling, I'm sorry.
For anything you're going to do today.
Exactly.
Before it even happened.
Exactly. No, but I'm saying it's a very simple human impulse that if you are the victim of a grave crime, if your family has suffered, and the perpetrator is there revealing the details, you know, you want to know. You want to know that the person has a bit of remorse in them for having conducted, having done this. I mean, the idea that they could be convicted and then sentenced to life imprisonment or a term of imprisonment, but still believe that they were not culpable. It's not something that with me works, but the truth-telling, I agree. The Arab Court of Justice in Bahrain, I can tell you very honestly, I haven't thought about it, but I will think about it now that you've raised it. So we'll have that discussion over coffee, and I'll look at it. The question on arts and culture, join our office. I don't think we've thought, have we thought about this? Pablo. Okay. Pablo's going to answer the question.
You can have a private conversation afterwards.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, talk to Professor Pablo de Grief. Listen, you're going to offer her a coffee as well? Yeah, okay. And the last question, Alliance of Truth Commissions. Perhaps, yes. I mean, there will be better practices, perhaps. But I think if these are devices for avoiding accountability altogether, accountability with a capital A, I am not in favor. If they are supplementary to, could be worked in, yes. I am in favor. Although with that basic question mark is that I'm not sure that we have gotten to the heart of why it is that we can rationalize so deeply to the point we can't say yes if there is no quid pro quo, no plea bargain, no thought that there could be a reduction of sentence. There is something missing there that I think we need to better understand.
I cannot let you go. One short answer about Colombia. I had hoped to leave us on what might be an up note.
Yes.
I lived in Colombia for 3 years as a correspondent in the mid-2000s, and like everybody else, I welcomed this agreement between the government and the FARC, what seemed to be a creative compromise on the balance between justice and peace. But just today, you might have seen some reports about the controversy over President Santos seeking presidential immunity in a deal with the FARC. On the one hand, it seems like the Colombian process could be an example in the global struggle against impunity. On the other hand, it's been criticized by Human Rights Watch, Amnesty International, and others for some of these arrangements. What's your take?
Well, I agree with you. I mean, there is a huge amount of hope that this conflict, having lasted for 50 or so years, now is coming hopefully to a close. But everyone understands as you reach the final last few millimeters, it's the hardest negotiation that will still remain outstanding. And yes, we've had constant discussions with them. What I admire is the creativity of thinking that is taking place. It doesn't mean that everything we hear will eventually be part of the agreement, but they are thinking elastically. Sometimes I think, yes, they perhaps, you know, when they, I would always prefer that you leave it to judicial discretion as to whether a defendant has been cooperating with the court, with the mechanisms that have been put in place, and not to prescribe it ahead of time. But they're trying hard as best they can to find formulae that will work with both sides, and we have to continue to work with them. It really is one of these in a barren landscape of hopeful stories, a hopeful story, but that the hard negotiation is now upon us is without a doubt, and there will be a back and forth on this. So I don't think, and given what we know about what has been said previously on amnesties, you know, we'll see how far this particular news story will continue and whether there is a withdrawal from it.
All right, well, hi, Commissioner Al-Hussein. Thank you so much for going the waterfront with us from human rights, impunity, transitional justice, and taking questions from all over the world. Really appreciate it. Please join me in giving the High Commissioner a big hand.